all individuals with their own story. And it's important that we remember that these aren't just numbers. They are real people. They are our friends, they are our neighbors, and they are our loved ones. And that is why we work every day to limit the spread of this virus and keep Virginia healthy and safe. It's why it is so important that everyone continue to please act responsibly to reduce the chances of getting or spreading the virus. We must keep working to protect each other. This weekend, we also mark a sad anniversary. This Sunday will be 1 year since 12 people were killed in the tragic shooting at the Virginia Beach Municipal Center. 12 precious lives were lost, and 4 forever altered by serious injuries. They were our mothers, fathers, wives, husbands, and children. Pam and I and the Commonwealth of Virginia join with their loved ones in mourning their loss. We know that grieving is not an event, but a process, and these families continue to live with their grief every day. We also join the Virginia Beach community, which was forever changed by this tragic event. Everyone felt this loss, from the coworkers to the first responders who ran toward danger and saved lives, to friends and neighbors. We are all proud of how the community has rallied to support the survivors and families in the immediate aftermath and in the year since then. We saw the compassion and kindness in people, and we continue to see it today. While the current pandemic limits our ability to come together physically, it does not limit our ability to honor the memories of those that were lost. So today, please join me in remembering Laquita Brown, Ryan Keith Cox, Tara Gallagher, Mary Louise Gale, Alexander Gusev, Joshua Hardy, Missy Langer, Richard Nettleton, Catherine Nixon, Christopher Rapp, Bert Snelling, and Bobby Williams. Please join me in a moment of silence in their memory. Thank you. I know Virginia Beach remains strong. I urge you all to wear blue this weekend in memory of them. Tomorrow, all localities in Virginia will have entered phase one. This includes Northern Virginia, Accomack County, and the city of Richmond. As a reminder, in phase one, non-essential retail and houses of worship may open at 50% capacity. Restaurants may have outdoor seating at 50% capacity. Gyms and fitness centers are allowed to conduct outdoor fitness classes. And salons and barbershops may operate with strict requirements for social distancing and face coverings. Again, I want to reiterate that just because a business is allowed to open doesn't mean that it must open. Also, starting tomorrow, everyone needs to wear a face covering in an indoor public space. As I have said, a face covering does not have to be elaborate. You can find plans on the internet to make your own mask out of cloth, even a bandana. And I would just like to take this opportunity, as you may imagine, I have had a lot of folks offer me masks and send them to me. I have one of them on today, and so I just wanted to publicly thank all of you for thinking of our best interests. Face coverings are a good idea because we know, and the CDC agrees, that face coverings in public reduce transmission of this virus. And it's just the right thing to do to protect the people around you as well as workers. If you shouldn't go into a public place without shoes or a shirt, you shouldn't go in without a face covering. You can see beside me and on the screen here a graphic that reminds people of the importance of wearing a face covering. We'll be sharing this with business groups so that they can print and display it if they so choose. It will be available on our website with translations into other languages. Now, I know that there are questions about how this is enforced. So I'm going to ask our counsel, Rita Davis, to come and discuss that with you. Rita, welcome.
Thank you, Governor. Rita Davis, counsel to the governor. The enforcement mechanism in Executive Order 633, which is also Amended Order of Public Health Emergency 5, is not a new process. It is a statutory process by which all orders of public health emergencies are enforced. This standard statutory process has been used in all five orders of public health emergency issued by the State Commissioner and in conjunction with the Governor's executive orders to date. It was not created specifically for Executive Order 63, and it is not new. Executive Order 63, however, relying on that very standard enforcement mechanism in Title 32.1 in the Health Code, provides two avenues by which the Department of Health or any local health department enforces the State Health Commissioner's order. The first is a civil process by which an injunction is obtained to enforce the public health order. The second is a warrant issued by a magistrate. Those are the procedures by which the governor has repeatedly stated he expects any enforcement to take place. But even then, the governor has stated that only gross, egregious, and repeated conduct in violation of the order should rise to the attention of the Department of Health. And although the governor does not expect business owners to enforce Executive Order 63, he does encourage them to take the opportunity to educate a non-compliant patron regarding the importance of wearing a face covering while inside the business. What is important to remember in all of this is that it should not be the responsibility of the Virginia Department of Health to make sure you are wearing your mask. And it certainly should not be the responsibility of law enforcement or a business to make sure you are wearing a face covering. Rather, it is the personal responsibility of each and every one of us to comply with Executive Order 63. It is the right thing to do, and it's the right thing to do to protect oneself, to protect one's family, and your fellow Virginians.
Thank you, Rita, and we will be available, obviously, at the end of this if there are any further questions on this particular issue. We will all remain in phase one for a minimum of another week so that we can continue to collect more health data. But our trends are encouraging. We are testing more people, and the percent of positive tests continues to trend downward. We continue to add to our testing capacity. Our testing is a combination of public testing events and tests that you can get at your doctor's office, medical clinic, or at pharmacies that are offering tests. Today, I'm really happy and excited to announce that 39 CVS pharmacies in Virginia will start offering testing using self-swab kits with an employee watching to make sure that you do it correctly. You can see on this slide where the CVS locations are in Virginia. This is just one of the partnerships we're working on to ensure that testing is widely available across Virginia. And to help Virginians understand how easy it should be to get a test, I intend to get tested soon as well. I'll have more updates on that next week. I also want to give you some updated PPE numbers. As we continue to get shipments in and distribute those supplies through our local health departments, regional healthcare coalitions, and localities. We sent out 200 shipments this week. including more than 30,000 N95 masks and more than 143,000 surgical masks. A shipment through our Northfield contract also landed yesterday with PPE, including more than 2 million K95 masks and nearly 5 million gloves. And now I'd like to briefly talk about our beaches. Last weekend, I visited Virginia Beach to check on how their comprehensive plan for reopening the beach worked. And from what I saw, it worked very well. Virginia Beach's plan for social distancing and sanitation is a model for other beaches to follow. So today, I'm announcing that as of tomorrow, other public beaches in Virginia may open to recreational activities as well. Social distancing will be required, and we will still maintain restrictions similar to what you saw for Virginia Beach. No large gatherings of more than 10 people, no tents, no alcohol, and no group sports. I expect everyone to follow the restrictions so that people can be safe while enjoying our beautiful beaches. Today, we are also revising our orders to allow NASCAR and other vehicle and horse racetracks to run single-day events under strict guidelines starting tomorrow. As a matter of fact, NASCAR will be running a race on June the 10th in Martinsville. These events will not be open to the public, and no spectators will be allowed, among other restrictions. Because these are open-air events with spacing between the participants, we believe there is minimal risk in allowing them to go forward with restrictions. We continue to devote our resources and energy to fighting the coronavirus. But I think it's encouraging and hopeful to also remember that we are committed to using every tool we have to help Virginia's economy recover. This week, we announced that Microsoft will invest $64 million to establish a new software development and research and development hub in Reston. This will create 1,500 new jobs, and we're glad to have all of them. And we expect to have more jobs announcements, including in rural parts of our state, in the next few days. We all know that while we have a health crisis, we also have an economic crisis. That's why it's so vitally important that we continue to create jobs and support our economy. Additionally, the foundation for a new wind turbine was just installed in federal waters off of our coast, just off of Virginia Beach. This is the first turbine foundation in U.S. federal waters and marking an important step as we continue to move toward a 100% carbon-free energy grid by 2050. In recent days, our DMVs have been slowly reopening a small number of customer service centers with appointments and other protective measures. Because there is a lot of demand for these services, I am extending the time Virginians have to renew expired licenses or ID cards. If your license or ID expires before July the 31st, you'll have until August the 31st to renew it. I'm also happy to announce that the federal government just agreed to extend Title 32 status for our Virginia National Guard. That means the federal government will continue to help pay for the work the Guard is doing to support our COVID response. They continue to do amazing, amazing work, especially with the testing that they're carrying on throughout our Commonwealth. As I've said before, if you see them at these testing sites, please, on behalf of all of us, thank them for their efforts. And finally, I want to speak to all the high school seniors, the college seniors, and the graduate students who would be participating in formal graduation ceremonies this spring. You have all worked for years toward the goal of graduating, and now that you have reached this milestone, you cannot celebrate it together with your classmates, friends, family, and teachers. And I know this must be very, very difficult. Tomorrow evening at 5 o'clock, Pam and I are thrilled to be hosting Virginia graduates together. A virtual statewide celebration of all of our graduates. This celebration will be carried live on Virginia Public Media, Blue Ridge PBS, WHRO, as well as streaming on Facebook Live and YouTube through these stations and WETA. I would really encourage everyone to tune in to support our graduates, and we have some very special guests you won't want to miss. This is a happy time for our graduates, so please be part of that celebration. I want to congratulate every graduate in Virginia. I am proud of you, your hard work, and your accomplishments, and I look forward to you all doing great things, especially here in the Commonwealth of Virginia. Now we'll have our Deputy Commissioner of Population Health, Dr. Laurie Furlano, speak to the health update, and then we'll be glad to take your questions. Dr. Furlano, welcome.
I just gotta put my glasses on here. Hi, good afternoon. On behalf of Dr. Oliver, I just wanted to provide a quick update on the numbers. Today, we have a total of 41,401 cases. That represents 1,152 new cases as of today in the last 24-hour reporting period. And we have a total number of deaths of 1,338, and that's 57 new deaths in that reporting, that same reporting period as well. All the other data that Dr. Oliver typically reports out on race, ethnicity, breakdowns, et cetera, I neglected to bring that with me today, but that's available on our website for your convenience. Thanks.
Be glad to take your questions.
Governor, yesterday one of my colleagues, Karina, interviewed a number of businesses with varying responses about the mask enforcement. Some will, some won't. Are we forcing business now to choose between health versus wealth?
Henry, I enjoy your questions. The question was, are we choosing between health and wealth? And the way I would answer that, Henry, is that I have said many a times, and I hate to repeat myself, but we're obviously in the middle of a health crisis. We're also in the middle of an economic crisis. And as soon as we can get the health crisis behind us, our economy will rebound and we'll get back to hopefully where we were prior to COVID-19. But until we can get the health crisis under control and behind us, our economy is never gonna recover completely. And I think the message, not only to consumers, but also to the businesses, and I'm a business owner, this recovery is consumer-driven. Consumers, and there are many Virginians that are following the guidelines and want to protect themselves and want to protect others. And so I would just encourage businesses to keep that in mind, and if consumers are on the sidewalk or wherever and don't feel comfortable going into a place of business, they're not going to go, and nobody's forcing their hand to go. So I would just encourage, you've heard me say this before, we are all in this together, and we can all hopefully choose to be part of the solution, and I don't think we have to make choices between health and wealth. They're both can be present at the same time, and I think we've done so well. I won't reiterate all that as a Commonwealth, where we are with our flattening of the curve and our hospital capacity and ventilators and our ability to test and the PPE. We're where we are today because of Virginians, and I say thank you to all of them, and we've got a long road ahead of us. And the only way we're going to get through this is to, you know, put the politics aside, put the jabs aside, and just be part of the solution. And that's what I encourage Virginians to do.
Lou Ann Reif with the Roanoke Times.
Hi, this is Amy Friedenberger from the Roanoke Times. The University of Virginia's weekly run of the model shows that with restrictions lifted May 15th, that cases are going to surge by thousands a day this summer, larger numbers than what we're seeing right now. And I'm wondering what your thoughts are on this model, and if cases were to spike like this, would you put business restrictions back in place statewide or regionally?
The second part of your question, if we see cases spike, if we see hot spots, again, we have better ability to test. We have better ability to do the tracing. And so if we get to the point where there are hot spots or areas that are having difficulties with numbers that are not going in the right direction, if you will, then obviously we'll make those adjustments. But, you know, as far as the University of Virginia model, I would have to sit down. I haven't looked at it in the last few days, but we have put in a lot of restrictions, especially holding Northern Virginia back for 2 weeks, Richmond, Accomack County. I don't know if the amount of testing that we have available and will have available plays into their model. So there are a lot of variables, but I guess it's just a general statement. We are looking at the data. I'm looking at today, what we have available. Obviously, the models are important. We have been following those, but we will just take this on a day-to-day basis. And again, as we move forward, and I think something that Virginians know, because I want to know, because I'm asked often, is when are we going to go into phase two? And the earliest that we'll do that is a week from tomorrow, which will be June the 5th.
Many Virginians who are doing the right thing, but there are many that for whatever reason have different convictions about what that is. What would be your guidance to a business that is facing a customer that very much wants to come in but doesn't want to wear a mask?
Mm-hmm.
And can they rest assured that if to avoid a confrontation they just decide to let them in, that their operating license won't be removed?
Yeah, the question is what to do if someone doesn't agree with the mask policy. And you know, Mel, I would reiterate that the intent of this is to do the right thing and to take care of those around you. It's not to lock people up in jail. And I would just tell you personally, as a business owner, if someone comes into my office and doesn't have a mask, I would, in a very nice way, say, would you mind wearing a mask for the safety of all of us in this office? And as a matter of fact, that's what we've done. And people have been very cooperative. Now, what the business, Mel, would choose to do after that, certainly you could say, well, you know, I'm in a medical office, for example, and my workers are very important to me. And if you're not willing to wear a mask, and by the way, we have some right here, then we're not going to offer you service today. But I would encourage nobody, and certainly we don't want businesses to be in the practice of enforcing this. I don't want, it's an awkward position for them to be in, and certainly don't want confrontations to occur. So I think, again, I would just ask people to do the right thing and think of others, and we'll move forward like that.
Bill Atkinson with the Progress Index.
Thank you. Governor, perhaps this question can be answered in hindsight. But if Northern Virginia and Richmond had not asked for their extensions like they had, is it a possibility that, in your opinion, Virginia could possibly enter in phase two this Friday and tomorrow, actually, instead of next Friday?
The question, if I heard it correctly, if Northern Virginia and Accomack County on the Eastern Shore and the city of Richmond had not asked for a delay of 2 weeks, would we be going into phase two sooner? The answer to that is no. The reason why we are waiting another week is because of the incubation period of this. We want to be very careful and deliberate as we move forward, and we just don't have the data yet to move into phase three, and we'll continue to follow that. I've had discussions with our epidemiologists as a couple of hours ago, and so we'll continue to monitor the data, and as soon as we feel comfortable that the trends are moving in a positive direction, then we will make the announcement as to when we can go into phase two.
Yeah, you mentioned on Tuesday that you don't want law enforcement to become involved with the enforcement of the new face covering requirement, and you also don't want businesses to be responsible for enforcing it. But I've been told by VDH that they won't be conducting inspections of businesses, and also actually just got a statement: if we receive information about an individual or individuals being non-compliant, we are going to encourage callers to bring the issue to the business owner immediately while the violation is occurring. So given that the enforcement does seem to lie, you know, with the business owner and law enforcement shouldn't become involved, what should a business owner do if someone refuses?
Well, Kate, in your case, I mean, if there's a person that repetitively chooses not to wear a mask, and I think in your question you said what does the business do in that case? And rather than having the business enforce that, the business would report that to the VDH, and then it would continue from there.
So. And would law enforcement become involved at all if the confrontation occurs?
I think you're asking a couple questions. The question was, would law enforcement be involved? Let me go back to the discussion I had about being a business owner. If someone were at my place of business and I nicely asked them to wear a mask and they chose not to and it became confrontational, then I would call our security and the law could be involved, but it wouldn't be about not wearing a mask. It would be about being confrontational and we would follow a different a line of enforcement in that. But as far as if there's a person that's repetitively not following the rules, then the business could notify the Virginia Department of Health, and then that investigation would take off in a different direction.
Mike Murillo with WTOP.
Governor, thanks for taking my question. Do you have any concerns in Northern Virginia with much of the area now laying out their plans to, in the near future, reopen? You have Prince George's County, you have D.C. You're getting a lot of areas in the D.C. region now reopening. Do you have any concerns about maybe a spike in activity because all the areas are reopening and moving to phase one?
That's a great question. And the question is, do I have concerns as we reopen Northern Virginia, Accomack County, the city of Richmond? Do we have concerns about the number spiking? And obviously, we'll be following that very closely. But the reason that we've been able to allow those regions to move into to phase one now is because we have had a decrease in the percent positivity. We have had a decrease in specifically in Northern Virginia of those hospital beds that are being used by COVID-19 patients. We have a better ability to test. We have been doing a lot more testing, as you have probably seen in Northern Virginia. And we have PPE. So, and we also have great leadership. In Northern Virginia, the mayors and the council members have been following this data closely, and they, with collaboration from the health department, have requested to move into phase one. So we feel comfortable moving forward, but we will obviously be watching the numbers as we move forward.
Yeah, you said the earliest that the state could move on to phase two is next Friday. So given that the minimum was meant to be 2 weeks for areas that are just starting phase one tomorrow, Richmond, Northern Virginia, mm-hmm. will they also have the opportunity to move potentially to phase two along with the rest of the state, or do they have to wait?
This is a great question. And, you know, if they're ready, and we'll obviously, the question was if the earliest date to move into phase two for Virginia is June the 5th, which is a week from tomorrow, will the three regions that chose not to enter phase one until tomorrow, will they have to wait? And we'll have that discussion, but if they're comfortable, Jackie, and again, I'll speak with the leaders in those areas and obviously look at the numbers, but if they're comfortable, I would really like to see everybody in Virginia, you know, moving together at the same time. So.
Roger Watson with the Farmville Herald.
Yes, thank you, Governor. If a community has experienced significant case increase with the phase one reopening, could that county request delaying its entry into phase two when that transition occurs?
I think if I heard the question correctly, if we all choose as a commonwealth to move into phase two, if there are certain areas that have concerns, obviously, could they delay moving into phase two? And again, that's a discussion that their local leaders will have, and we'll discuss that at our level and make that decision. But as I've said all along, we have a floor, and nobody's going to go faster than our floor. But if an area is not comfortable for any number of reasons, we'll certainly be open to their discussions.
Center, and I think a dozen or so lawmakers asked you to put forward a temporary moratorium on evictions.
Ned, I appreciate the question. The question was regarding evictions, and as I've said all along, these are difficult times for all of us, but especially for individuals that are threatened not to have a roof over their head. So we have several pathways in place, and I've talked about those a number of times. I could go through that again, but I don't intend to, as of today, changing anything moving forward. But I would just encourage the landlords and the tenants and all of us to know that we're in difficult times and really find ways to work through this so that, just like we talked about utilities, I mean, this is, you know, about people having a roof over their head during a pandemic. And so we all as a society need to come together to figure out how to do that.
From the other side of things, I've heard landlord groups encourage the state and local governments to use federal emergency grants to help people catch up on them. Is that something you've talked about at the state level?
Yeah, and I've actually got my Secretary of Finance here, and there are means to use the relief funds, and I just off the top of my head, I will have to get back with you on that. I'm not sure if we can use those funds for that particular reason, but you have heard me talk about flexibility, and so the more flexibility we have from the federal level as to how we can use those funds, the better we're able to do things like that. But I will try to get back with you on that. Yes, thank you for the question.
Greg Hambrick with Inside Nova.
Governor, to circle back to this situation of masks and a business owner's rights, can you speak a little bit more clearly to a business owner's right to refuse service to anyone who might not wear a mask?
Rita, do you want to answer that? Did you hear the question?
Yes, sir.
If a business can refuse service to someone on behalf of them not wearing a mask.
Thank you, Governor. As I understand the question, it's whether a business owner can refuse service to someone who refuses to wear a mask. Is that correct?
Yes. Just to stay clearly, the governor had spoken to business owners trying to work with customers who don't want to wear a mask and encourage them to. The business owners have the right to refuse service to someone who doesn't wear a mask, correct?
Well, I think as the governor has stated, business owners have the opportunity to have a discussion with someone who is not compliant about the importance of having a mask and wearing that mask. If that patron still refuses to be persuaded by the business owner, certainly the business owner can ask that patron to maybe return at a different time when they are more convinced they should be wearing a mask. Thank you.
Governor, I think the last 2 days with daily deaths have been at their highest point. Is that a concern? And I assume it's too soon to attribute that to any reopenings given the...
Yeah, the question, Laura, I appreciate that, is that the last couple of days we have seen a large number of deaths, and certainly every death is one too many. Laura, I maybe could talk about when they come in, and yeah, thanks for that.
Mm-hmm. Hi, the question was about the death data, and death data is a lagging indicator, so it does take time, mostly because of we have to wait for death certificates to come in to validate that information, so it does typically lag behind. So you're right that not only would it be, even if it were real time, it would be a little too soon to attribute it to a phase one reopening, but even further so because of the lag.
David McGee with the Bristol Herald Courier.
Yes, thank you, Governor. I wanted to ask, you said that the data is trending in the right direction, but it seems like over the last few days you seem to be adding about 1,000 or more cases per day. Can you address that aspect of it?
The question is the trending of numbers, and certainly we look at the number of new cases, and a lot of that depends on how many we're testing. And so, as you've seen the last few days, we've tested in the ballpark of 10,000, some days a little bit more than 10,000, some days less. And so the more we're testing out there, the more positives we're seeing. But our percent positivity rate, if you look at today, is around 11% off the top of my head. So those numbers, the percent positivity tend to be trending down. And that's we're looking at both of those, but certainly you all remember the curve, the yellow curve that comes down, that continues to head in that direction over a seven-day period. So again, we'll follow that very closely, but we're testing more, which is what we've been asking for. We're seeing more positives, and we'll continue to follow the percent positivity.
Governor, two-parter. One regarding back to the mask order. I know, I believe the council talked about the right to refuse for those not wanting to wear a mask, but for the exceptions in there, such as the medical conditions, do businesses still have a right for someone who falls under the exception portion? And then the other part, I had missed this on Tuesday, but you had extended the state of emergency declaration indefinitely, as far as I can tell. Can you explain just why you did that?
So two questions, Cameron. I appreciate it. The first is exceptions, and if you look at our guidelines, there are obviously individuals that have exceptions to wearing, or that allow them not to wear a mask. And you know, I think that's just their word. And if someone says, I'll just give you an example, asthma or COPD, chronic obstructive pulmonary disease, and they have a problem with oxygenation, and obviously wearing a cloth mask is not in their best interest. So all of those exceptions, if someone came in a place of business, again, putting myself in that position, if someone said, I've got asthma, COPD, or my child has this or that, we really don't feel comfortable, I said, you know, sure, just, you know, maintain your social distancing, and you're welcome to be in here. So I think everybody would work with them regarding their exceptions. The other question you asked was our state of emergency, and why is that important? The state of emergency allows us to do a lot of things. It allows us to use our National Guard, as you know. It also allows, I'll give you another great example, it allows us to work with Medicaid and have telehealth compensated. And so what we didn't want to happen was just, well, on June the 10th, we've got to go from, for example, seeing patients through telehealth. Now all these patients have to come into our office, or would be required to come into our office. So it gives us a lot more flexibility. And rather than set a definite date, I just wanted to do it an undetermined date so that we would have more flexibility. And those are just two examples, but there are a lot of other things that it allows us to do as well.
Tracy Agnew with the Suffolk News Herald.
Hello, thank you. My question is, has Accomack County, do you believe that they have met the metrics for entering phase one as far as the percent positivity trending downward, hospitalizations trending downward, and the other metrics that you've been watching?
The question is about Accomack County, and we have been in contact with the leaders in Accomack County. We've also spent a lot of time, spent a lot of resources doing testing in our meat processing plants. National Guard, as you probably remember, was working with our nursing homes on the Eastern Shore. The Virginia Department of Health has been there. The CDC has been there. So a lot of efforts have been placed in Accomack County. And yes, working with their leaders, we feel comfortable. And we also, by the way, did community testing. And I remember the community testing was like 2 to 3%, so it was fairly low compared to the meat processing plant. So bottom line, we feel comfortable moving into phase one in Accomack County. Their leaders do as well, and we'll continue to follow the trends there.
Governor, can you give an example of the kind of cases that might attract the Department of Health's attention, these sort of egregious, repeated? Is this someone like traveling between businesses? I'm just trying to imagine like what the scenario would be in that situation. And then just a sort of broader question, I mean, it seems like mask wearing has become sort of politicized. Are you concerned at all that this order would just inspire a backlash rather than compliance?
Well, let me answer the second part of your question first. It's whether about masks being politicized. And I made the point earlier, Ben, that we need to get the politics out of this. This is about a health crisis. This is about taking care, making sure other people are safe. and it's about getting the health crisis behind us so we can move forward with our economic recovery. And so again, you know, I can't lead everybody to the water, but I'm going to lead as many people as I can. The second part, or actually the first part of your question, is what type of case would we find where VDH through the health code needs to be notified? I could give you all kinds of scenarios, and I think it's very difficult to draw the line anywhere in particular. But I would just encourage everybody to, as best they can, to follow our guidelines. I just wanted to, in closing, remember the over 1,000 people that have lost their lives in Virginia. Remember the families and loved ones of our fallen victims in the Virginia Beach tragedy a year ago. And as we move forward, there's still a lot of questions, issues that people have, and two that I'm going to address on Tuesday that I've heard a lot of questions about. One is youth sports, and we're in the summer months, and we really want to encourage our families and our children to get out there and be active and get some fresh air, but want to make sure they do it safely. And so we'll have some guidelines to provide Virginia on Tuesday regarding that. The other question that I hear, and Pam and I have two children, they're grown now, but if I had children at home, I would be asking this question, is when are our children going to be safely able to get back into our schools? And I just wanted to let you know that there are a lot of people, we're having a lot of great discussions led by our Secretary of Education, Adif Carney, our Superintendent of Public Instruction, James Lane. We had a meeting this morning regarding that. And so we'll have some more announcements on Tuesday. But we're going to do everything that we can to make sure that your children can get back into the classrooms and that they can get back there safely and responsibly. And I just wanted to let you know a lot of discussion, a lot of effort is going into that decision, and I'll have more to say about that on Tuesday. So in the meantime, I appreciate you all viewing today and hope all of you have a good weekend, and we'll look forward to being with you on Tuesday. Thank you very much.